Now, Midge Ure has launched tickets for a new autumn tour, November and December, and he's coming this way, coming to Truro and to Torquay, and he's with me on the show. How you doing, Midge?
I'm doing incredibly well, thank you.
Back out on the road again.
Well, you can't keep an old man down, can you? It's, you know, there's something that about touring. It's in the blood. It's like blinking or breathing to me. I don't have to think about it. It's something I've always done. So yeah, another one.
But I think you've said before that you prefer being out on the road to, as much as you love being in the studio, but out on the road is the place where you really, really love to be.
Well, it's what came first, isn't it? When you think about it, you know, the old school style. You formed a band with your mates. You if you're lucky enough to have a guitar, and you meet someone else who's got a guitar, and before you know it, there's three or four of you, and that's your first band. And you go out and you play and you perform, and hopefully build up the ability to be, you know, a player, you know, maybe a little bit of a writer or whatever, long before you're ever allowed anywhere near a studio, because studios back in the day were uberly expensive things to do. So performing live always came, it's the cart before the horse, really, it's the horse before the cart, properly. So it always came before you were allowed to make a record. And that's what I've always done, and that's what I'll continue to do till I can do it no longer.
Isn't it strange, though, how things have flipped around? Because now you can make pop stars overnight from their bedroom, and then they go out and tour a record which has had so many million plays on TikTok, for instance.
Well, I was watching a documentary the other night about George Michael, and I saw George at the peak of his success in America, when Faith was a massive, massive record. And I went to see him in some mega dome in California somewhere. And in between the songs, I mean, he was brilliant for him, brilliant singer, brilliant performer. But in between the songs, there was like a 2-minute break where he didn't say anything. And you think, that's because it all happened so quickly for Wham. They didn't have the luxury of going out and standing in a church hall in front of 25 people learning how you do that stuff. So it's, yes, it's very different now. You can go on a reality TV program or a talent program or whatever, then figure out how to go on stage. But that's a very different animal.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm just going to take you back to the early 80s, because I go down rabbit holes on certain video streaming websites, Midge. I'm sure you know what I'm talking about.
I do as well. Sad, isn't it?
It is, but it's actually quite a nice way to waste 2 hours sometimes when there's nothing on telly. And I was going over the old Blitz Club videos and the New Romantic stuff, and it recommends, you know, this, that, and watch that. And then one of them was a report of Ultravox using this new thing called a synthesizer. And it was on a really posh news show. It wasn't a hip pop show. It was on this news show, something like Nationwide or something. And you were explaining how you could, you know, by moving that button, you could change the sound. And this, it was just so incredible to see the genesis of how bands started using synthesizers.
Well, they were machines, weren't they? I mean, I think I know the type of thing you're talking about. It was very BBC.
Yes.
Very, very posh. And here's Midge with his new machine.
Yeah, that's the one, yeah.
Yeah, they were machines, and none of us knew exactly what to do with them. I mean, I bought my first synthesizer in 1978 when it was in the band The Rich Kids, which immediately broke the band in half. Half the band hated it, and half the band loved the prospect of incorporating this thing into, you know, guitar, drums, and bass. And it was as punk was, you know, when people picked up a guitar and learned three chords and formed a band, and they played those three chords very fast, you know, and that was it. They were a punk band. You got a synthesizer and you figured out the keyboard and you figured out how to create a sound on the thing. And what normally happens was you'd have a sound in your head that you think you try and get to. But on the way to trying to develop this sound on the synthesizer, you'd find something much more interesting. And that's how it developed. So it was flying by the seat of your pants, in a way, until I joined Ultravox in the late 70s. It was through buying that synthesizer on The Rich Kids, breaking the band up, forming Visage, One of the guys in Visage we really wanted to work with was Billy Curry, keyboard player with Ultravox. So when I joined Ultravox, they knew what they were doing with those machines. So it was a new toy that was seen as a bit of a novelty for a while.
Yeah.
It's now, it's de rigueur. It's the same as when the saxophone came out in the 1920s or whatever. It was considered not a real brass instrument, but this certainly is now, you know.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Well, that leads me nicely into Fade to Grey. So can I just play that and then we'll be back and we'll talk a little bit more?
Please do.
Midge Ure is with us on the show today, Midge is coming to Truro and to Torquay with the new tour. It's called Catalogue, the Hits Tour. So I'm guessing that this is kind of whatever you want to play that you've been involved in throughout your career.
Yeah, which is kind of what I do anyway. it's just as a different title, you know. When you're thinking, well, normally a tour would be associated with a new album, so you'd call the tour the whatever the album was called tour, and of course there isn't a new album. I'm still working on it.
Is there one coming though?
Oh, there is one coming, but okay. I realised the other day I've been working on the new one for 10 years. Time flies. It really does. I must be going down too many rabbit holes looking at old videos that you've just explained. I thought Catalogue covers a multitude of sins, because I could, if I chose to go all the way back to Slick in the mid-70s, which I don't think I will, but I might incorporate some Rich Kids, and I might incorporate a little bit of Thin Lizzy. I'm not sure. It gives me a very wide spectrum of what I can perform in and amongst the hits, which, of course, if I don't play, I would be hung, drawn and quartered for and never allowed outside.
You wouldn't get out of the venue, Midge. You know that. See, on my list, I know there is absolutely zero chance you're going to play either of these, but I still play these songs regularly at home, and that is Passionate Reply.
Okay.
And Waiting. And both of those were B-sides, which I absolutely, and still to this day, love.
Well, thank you very much. Passionate Reply, I did on a tour three or four years ago, and it worked incredibly well. I hadn't played it live since the Ultravox days, just after we wrote it. Waiting, I'm not sure I've ever performed that live. Ultravox may have done it once or twice, but I've certainly not done it. I wouldn't rule anything out right now. You know, I have to make this. It's a multifaceted thing doing a tour. You have to appease the audience that are there. You have to appease certainly half the audience who were dragged along by the significant other half who don't know any of your stuff at all and would probably be at home going down a rabbit hole instead. And you have to please yourself. So unless you're happy about doing what you're doing and performing what you want to perform, it's going to come across like painting by numbers.
Yeah.
So I constantly rejig and rework and re-energize the old stuff that people expect to hear. So don't rule anything out yet.
Okay, all right. Okay, good. Well, but the thing is, though, that you can, because you've clearly got a different instrumentation lineup, the songs are going to sound fresh anyway, whether you do them. I've heard you do the acoustic version of Vienna on tour before with just the fiddle, you know, with the Indie Electric Company. Absolutely brilliant. So it all sounds different anyway to the record.
I think that's the key to it. I mean, there are certain songs that you cannot not play. And I've played those songs in many different formats, you know, from full orchestra to just an acoustic guitar to the three-piece acoustic thing with the Indie Electric Company. You know, the Indie Electric boys are still, they'll be part of Band Electronica this time as well. And they're probably doing their own set beforehand, like we did on the last tour, because it's great for them to perform in front of a larger audience, because they are, don't tell them, very talented boys. You know, so yes, I can, and I have the flexibility to be able to think, okay, well, tonight let's do the acoustic version of Vienna, or let's do the full band, you know, version that people remember the sounds, get recreate that atmosphere, not necessarily the record, but recreate the essence of the atmosphere. So I have the ability to do all of that, and that's what keeps those songs fresh, and certainly fresh for me to perform.
Midge Ure is with us on the show today. Midge coming to Cornwall and Devon, Truro and Torquay, later on this year. Actually, let me give you the dates, because it's between the 15th and 18th of December. So you can do They Know It's Christmas, Midge. Actually, can't you, on this tour?
I just can't drag everybody along to help me sing it. I didn't sing it in the first place.
No, you didn't, did you? 17th of November at the Hall for Cornwall in Truro, and the 18th of November at the Princess Theatre in Torquay. Have you got any idea what your set list is going to be yet, or is it way too far in the future to think about that?
Way too far in the future. Yes, it can change on a daily basis. It's a bit... It's funny, songs are funny things. You're responsible for them, you created them, and a bit like your children, and you love them dearly, but sometimes they annoy you, and it depends what day it is. And I think, well, this one's my current favourite, and then you think, well, no, that one, no, and this one's now my favourite. So it will morph and shape itself into some kind of form prior to the tour starting, I hope. Otherwise, we're in big trouble.
Yeah. We're doing on the show today weird celebrity claim to fames. I've got one involving you.
Okay.
So I wanted to save it until you came on. And it's, I think it's the, it's October 1981, Cornwall Coliseum, right? You're on tour with Ultravox. And the Coliseum's no longer there as a venue. It's been knocked down, unfortunately. It's some great venues we've lost over the years. But anyway, they had these back steps going up to the dressing rooms at the Coliseum. We used to queue there so we could then get taken up by the security to meet the band and say hello and get your autograph. And then you get whisked out the next door. And my silly celebrity claim to fame is that whilst you were autographing my Ultravox tour program from the gig, I held your I'm going to say it's orange juice, but I'm pretty sure it was a vodka and orange. your vodka and orange whilst you were signing my program. So that is my weird celebrity claim to fame.
I love it. As long as you didn't drink it.
No, I didn't drink it. or maybe I'm doing you a disservice. Maybe it was a refreshing orange juice after you've come off the stage to protect your voice.
Obviously a refreshing orange juice. Obviously.
But yeah, there we are. So your story about George Michael is quite an interesting one. Have you got any weird, because I know you're kind of a celeb yourself, but have you had any weird moments with celebrities in the past that you can think of? Actually, that's a little silly little claim to fame that I can come up with.
You know what? I'm not quite sure. Everyone tells you not to work with your heroes. And it's not been the case for me. Everyone I respect and admire who I worked with, either in the studio or on stage, has been amazing. You know, simply because people forget that we all get into this industry because we're fans of someone else. You know, because someone's inspired you. You heard a piece of music you loved, and you think, that would be great to do that. And the fantasy is that you'll get to meet them one day and you'll get to work with them. And they've all been fantastic, I have to say, unbelievable. There was one moment where I'm going to do some dreadful name dropping here.
Carry on.
here we go. Yeah, at Eric Clapton's roast for, I think it was his 25th anniversary or something, I was invited along to that, which was amazing. And Pete Townsend did a roast on Clapton where he just ripped him to shreds, which is what roasts are all about. It was very funny and brilliantly written, and Eric took it incredibly well. And at the end of the night, they had all this equipment set up on stage, and they said, right, okay, guys, let's all go up and let's have a jam. And I tried to get on stage, and I think it was pushed out the way by one of the Rolling Stones, who obviously, I could see it in his eyes, thinking, where do you think you're going, Sonny? Yeah. You know? I was put well and truly in my place and ended up standing in the audience watching what I should have been up there playing.
Yeah, we'll go with that. Pushed off stage by one of the Rolling Stones. Yeah, we like that one. That's very good. Yeah. Well, look, it's been great to talk to you again, Midge. Thank you ever so much. And we'll see you on tour in November.
Fantastic. Looking forward to it.